Well, we are entering into the most interesting time in the history of the planet as we go forward in September right now. The 23rd of September is quite a date. The more you look into it, the more astonishing it is. This has been known about apparently for quite some time. The French foreign minister, 500 days prior to the 23rd of September, just mentioned, I think there was two mentions of it, we have 500 days to avoid, you know, climate chaos. And you go forward and you end up at September 23rd from the date of that statement. But there's many more indications. And then, is it just sheer coincidence then that the Pope and the President are meeting in the White House on September 23rd? Sheer coincidence. It's not possible. It's quite extraordinary. So, you know, we have, what, 9 days for this? So it's an extraordinarily interesting time in the world. I look at, like, the seventh game of the World Series. And today, I was praying to God. I said, you know, God, it's time to bring in the relievers. You know, in the baseball game, you have these expert relievers who, in a dangerous situation, they shut the door, and you know, and I said, it's time to bring these relievers in, because we're in a super, super dangerous situation now, and we don't want to lose this game, and you better bring the experts in right now. You better bring them in. And I'm very intensely focused on this today. It's time to bring the experts in to help us out right now. And I've been saying this for quite some time, that at some point we have to have something has to show up in this world that is can deal with what's going on in the world. And we've dwelled on this throughout hundreds and hundreds of videos. People say the New World Order, you know, I call it cosmic corporate culture coming. And is there some agenda that the world is pursuing? Yes, of course there is. There is an agenda the world is pursuing. And it's a corporate agenda. It's is it backed by, you know, the Illuminati, Club of Rome, Committee of 300, Tavistock Institute, you know, Stanford Research Institute, Grand Corporation, you know, military industrial complex, as Eisenhower said, and shadow world government, and the banksters, and Federal Reserve, and, you know, you just go on and on and on and on of all this conspiracy, you know, entities and stuff. Well, of course they're all involved in it. it's obvious, you know. But history, the pages of history, you know, are always kind of, you know, being turned in this way and that way. But there is definitely a massive push, and they're very desperate. They're very desperate. I can feel the desperation. And so we're coming to this point where they have claimed that there's this desperate climate situation, that if we don't solve it right now, if we don't have a worldwide, all-out campaign to solve this global warming problem, we're all doomed. The human race is going to perish. This is their ideology. Now, it's a nice way to push through whatever they want to push through, isn't it? So, I feel we're at this most drastic time. And so I'm saying, God, it's time to bring in the heavyweights. It's time to bring in the relievers. We've gone as far as we can go. We're tired, you know. I'm tired. I've pushed as hard as I can possibly push, and it's still the desperation of those who want to, basically, it's the egoic continuity for agenda, which is to say that we're all humans, and that's our only identity, and you know. Let's try to be happy as humans, and let's keep continuity for this unacknowledged, and let's make pretending this pretense, which is what it is. Let's make it permanent. This is their goal, to you know, wall us off from spiritual truth. This is the goal of continuity fear, is to convince us forever that it doesn't exist, and we're human. The pretense is real. This is its goal. And so this is a terrible, terrible goal for everybody. So I'm saying, hey, Holy Spirit, you know, it's the critical time right now. It's the turning point, and you should treat this as if it was absolutely crucial, because the desperation of those who are trying to, you know, follow the dance of the continuity fear is very desperate now. So here I am with this plea today. Plea, I'm pleading all day long. I'm pleading, 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 and the Holy Spirit indicates, you know what? You've got to keep working at getting in shape, because you let yourself go for a long time. For the last couple of years, you've been just full on push, not doing anything. So go out and play some golf. Here's a good deal for you. And I said, wow, I don't know if I can handle this one, but I will try. So I get out there and I'm playing golf and I'm praying and I'm praying. I says, God, you got to do a miracle today, a miracle today. Well, no miracles are happening. And I got very depressed and I said, wow, all is lost. It seems like this is terrible. There's really no indication of anything happening. So I get on the 18th tee and, you know, I tee the ball up and I'm lining my shot up, getting ready to hit, and suddenly I hear some noise off to the left there, in front of me, just to the right, to the far right, in front, off the far right there, there's this noise, and suddenly this deer comes bursting out of the bushes, and it trots right past me, right past the tee ground, and just trots, and I said, wow, that's shocking, you know. And then I hear some more noise. And another deer bursts out of the same area, and it also follows the first one past me. And then a third deer, and this must have been the mother deer, is a big one. And it bursts out of the thicket there. And I'm like, wow, this is just, I was quite stunned by what has suddenly happened here. And I look at the deer, and suddenly the deer just stops. Dead stop like this, and just looking straight at me, and I'm looking straight at the deer, and I say, whoa, you know, what's going on here? I kind of wait, and the deer's not moving, and I'm not moving, and I start thinking, you know, what do I do, what do I do, what do I do, what do I do here? And it's almost like the deer was saying, oh, sorry to interrupt your golf game. You know, I didn't mean, my kids didn't know better, but they ran in front of you, were ready to tee off, and they ran in front of you, and I'm sorry about it, but, you know, I got better etiquette than that. I saw someone's on the tee, I got to stop. That's exactly like that. The deer wasn't afraid, wasn't trying to run away. It was just kind of just sitting there, you know, just stopped, just looking at me. And I say, huh. Why, what's okay? Let me. I was trying to think. What do I do? Oh, the deer is it waiting for me to tee off? And I said, well, I'm not kind of nervous right now, in shock, so I don't want to tee off right now. And plus, the youngsters are out in the fairway there, pretty close. So I said, you know what? Well, why don't I show some good etiquette to the deer, and wave the deer through? So I did this motion. Come on, come on, come on. Just like that. Waved my hand like that to the deer. Go through. And as soon as I did that, the deer said, oh, and just starts trotting right past me like that. So okay. Like it knew exactly what I was doing, motioning it through. I just motioned it through with my hand like this. Now, how does a deer know that this motion means, oh, okay, it's okay to come on through now? I don't know. I have no idea, you know, and I was just astonished by this. Does the deer know human sign language or something? If it's just looking at me now, and when I waved, go through, then it immediately went on through. Maybe the deer knows golf etiquette, I don't know. But what's important is, three deer bursting out of a thicket on the right, and then going right in front of me like this. One, two, three. The deer, if you look it up, the deer is a very, very spiritual symbol. Some say the deer represents the core self, the true self. And it's, you know, it's elusive. You don't see where the deer is. I didn't see it it happened suddenly. Just burst right out. Just boom, there's the deer. Three times. A sudden emergence of the self. And as they were running, the third one, as it was running, it was going on all fours, and then it started bounding two and two. It was beautiful as it went through like this, you know. And I was like, hey, this is something very spiritual that just took place. This is a sign of something. I've been praying. God, you got to help bring the believers in, you know, the ones who are more talented than we are, the ones that really know how to slam the door on all troubles for us. And here we have the symbol of three deers, three spiritual entities suddenly bursting on the scene like this. So I took it to mean that this is God's answer to my prayer, saying there are three teachers coming, three teachers who, you know, who've dropped all pretense and valuing, and know themselves to be eternal life, the spirit, formless spirit, that is eternal life, undefinable. That they're about to burst upon the scene. Now, the ego had been tormenting me all day and some of last night, because last night I did some digging into some the 60s, because the 60s, a lot of very weird stuff happened then, and to say the very least, and went back and over and found some new information. And I realized, no, my God, no wonder why we had such a difficult time. It was just, it's horrible what took place back then. And we're discovering, we continue to discover that the shadow government, which Eisenhower said, the military-industrial complex, which, may have false flagged Kennedy assassination and taking Kennedy out, that group, Eisenhower said, that's the biggest threat we have, is the military-industrial complex. He's talking about the shadow government of these massive corporations and think tanks and committees and groups and those behind the scenes, very powerful people behind the scenes, really trying to take over the world and behind the scenes taking over the world. Eisenhower knew about it, and he warned us. Well, that was back, you know, in 1960, you know, I believe, when he was, that was his final address to the nation before Kennedy took over. Well, we're finding out more and more, but this was happening back then. It was very much happening. So I was digging through this and finding more information. It's like, wow. That rings true. A lot of it rings true. And just having lived through it all, we were spooked. Yeah, literally, I mean, the spooks were doing all sorts of stuff. And it's just almost unbelievable. But of course, we now know about all the spying that's been done recently under the Patriot Act. And with like shock, too. It's like, oh my gosh, they're spying on everybody. Well, there seems to be no limit to, you know, what this global cabal will do. I mean, they have an agenda and an end game, and they do whatever they feel they need to do. So, you know, I was really on a bummer, as we call it. I got really down and depressed and everything about going through this. It was just, it's so sordid, really. So it was great to get this symbol, this symbol of the three deers, and I realized I've been thinking we're desperate, we're really desperate now, and then suddenly the Holy Spirit flipped the script and said, no, you're not desperate. It's they're the ones who are desperate, and that's why we have a problem, because they're so desperate right now to succeed that they're liable to do anything. And this is why we need help and protection and refuge. We're not in some, you know, desperate, crazy state of mind at all. But we're saying, hey, you know, they certainly are. You know, they'll do any false flag they need to do. I mean, you just, I've gotten a tremendous amount of indication that there's going to be turmoil, strong turmoil. Dream last night, terrible turmoil in that dream. Someone was up on him, flinging this muddy rock, this mud and rocks, flinging it down into the world. It was just awful, terrible situation. So we need to be protected from their desperation, because we're just not used to, you know, spirit acting in a desperate way. It kind of freaks us out, actually. It's so weird, you know. And it's that. So we need to be protected from the weirdness. And speaking of weirdness, you know, the 60s were extraordinarily weird. Freakish, you might call it. You say people are freaking out. Well, literally, I mean, I thought the hippie movement started in the Bay Area, and I'd say about 99% of the world believes this. But apparently it didn't. It started in Los Angeles, Laurel Canyon. And the people there were called freaks. And we heard about the freaks, and they would go into these nightclubs that popped up suddenly like mushrooms there, very conveniently, and would dance like freak, just dressed in crazy costumes. Nobody's seen anything like it, the way they dance, and they're the ones that drew a crowd, these dancers in Hollywood, Hollywood's Sunset Strip, and so. And there was a leader of the freaks down there, and they were taking drugs and acid, and this scene, the L.A. scene, was actually going for a while before the whole San Francisco scene got going. And thinking back, I look at it, I say, you know what? I think that's accurate, actually. There was something really weird going on in Los Angeles, to tell you the truth. Very, very strange, and didn't feel right. And of course, it ended with Charles Manson, 1969. That brought a screeching end to the hippie peace and love era. And yet he was a Laurel Canyon regular, you see. I mean, he was integrated into that whole scene. And a lot of the music came out of that place. And I talked about how I found out that they didn't, you know, play on the records. They didn't play the instruments at all. It was all the Wrecking Crew, studio musicians that did the albums, basically did most of them, which I found to be very suspicious. I said, when I found that, I said, there's something that doesn't add up here. And so people are digging into it. It was very weird. The whole LA scene was very, very, very weird, as was the San Francisco scene with music and with the hippie, the counterculture, the hippie, whole hippie move, the freak movement. And the freaks continued on for quite some time. They were heavily, heavily involved in music and very demanding. I know a lot of musicians had problems with them. They would pester them and say, hey, you need to do this. This is how you need to play, man. You need to you know, be true to the be a freak, you know. And so more and more information started to trickle out, and people were trying to put the pieces of the puzzle together. And was the government involved? Was the shadow government involved? All the alphabet agencies, et cetera, et cetera. Well, you know, well, there's smoke, and a lot of smoke, and more smoke. There's probably some fire to it, actually. Was there a lot of, involvement? Probably. The whole thing didn't feel right to me. The whole 60s, there's something, everybody seemed to know that, you know, the man, they're trying to control us. There's something going on that isn't right. There's something happening here. What it is, I'm not exactly clear, you know. Speaking of that, Laurel Canyon, there's a song called 1230 by Mamas and Papas. And, you know, the lyric says there's, and I think there's, like, they're talking about, I used to live in New York City, all the streets there were dark and dirty. Outside the church there was a steeple with a clock that always read 1230, with a clock that always read 1230. Well, there you have the 2-3, right? 2-3, September 23rd. And then I'm guided to that get off of my cloud where, you know, the 9-9, ninth month, September, I live in an apartment on the 99th floor of my block, and I sit at home looking out the window, imagining that the world has stopped. Interesting stuff. It seems as though we went down the rabbit hole in the 60s. I didn't like the 60s at all. I hated the 60s, actually. There was too much weird stuff going on. Stanford Research Institute was just doing all sorts of stuff. They all were. Massive human experimentation, all sorts of psychops, funding this, funding this, funding this, funding this, funding this, psychology experiments. You had this military industrial complex that had very strong overtones from Operation Paperclip, and all the, Nazis coming over to the United States after the war. You have Tavistock, Institute in England with its hands on everything, having all these psychiatrists, try to figure out, how to control the world, really, which, you could feel something that wasn't right at all. And when I went back there and looked at it again, it still felt terrible. It still felt terrible. I was really like going back and it's like terrible. But this has all been going on and on and on, like a snowball. And it seems as though they've reached their objectives. I mean, if you look at some of the objectives that they were said they were trying to reach, you'd say, wow, we're there. Basically, we're there. Break down the family, pornography. There's a whole massive host of objectives for some reason. And these people were not nice. The vibe was not good. It was not a good vibe in the 60s. It was a very tense vibe. There were battles going on, but people didn't trust one another. There's a lot of narcs. There's a lot of undercover police. There's a lot of undercover action. If you look at it, you scratch your head and say something isn't right. The radical feminists, that movement, who was funding that, for instance, and they ended up, I mean, it seemed like a tremendous amount of trust fund people, wealthy people, young people, ended up in positions of great power and authority, and nothing ever happened to them. This is another thing, it's very odd. Everybody back then lived in fear of being busted. I mean, drugs were very much illegal and severe prison sentences, etc. And yet these musicians that for instance, Laurel Canyon, nobody ever got busted. Nobody ever got drafted either. And like Ram Dass is bagging a Timothy Leary, say, I've never been busted. How is that possible? That's crazy. I mean, something was not fair, was not right. Some people had privilege. And it's like even the counterculture, some people had privilege in it. We realized that, hey, these people are bulletproof. Nothing happens to them. This is weird. If I did that, I'd be in jail instantly, So we looked up to them like these young people, like heroes, like, hey, you're getting away with all this stuff. These people were committing all sorts of crimes, underage girls, extreme drug abuse, and nothing happened to them. Except the media promoted them more and more and more and more. And so we're looking at this as youth and saying, look at these people. They're untouchables. They're like superheroes. We couldn't understand it or explain it, really. But we said, wow, I wish we, were somewhat like them as far as, I wish we weren't living in fear of as young people usually live in fear of authority to some extent. I wish we could be out front like that. I wish we could. And so they were kind of our cultural heroes. But as we look back now with hindsight, it's sort of a different picture emerges. It seems it could very well be they were intentionally being protected. They were intentionally getting away with all of this. It was all very purposeful. The hidden hand was very much at work. And I was always puzzled by the Beatles too. They were powerful beyond anything you could really quite explain. And some say that that they were the one of the prime operatives of the Tavistock Institute. The confidence that the Beatles had, they're like royalty. They're like untouchable. Yeah, I said, is this something is just not right here? These are just some lads from Liverpool? Come on. There's no way. I mean, you look back, you just look back on it, and you have to conclude that intelligence operations were being carried out behind the scenes. Why did Brian Epstein, Beatles manager, commit suicide? You know, I mean, the whole scene, was just perplexing and extremely confusing for very sensitive people at that time. I was one of them. I said, I can't figure this out. Feeling wise, I could not figure it out. I said, so, you know, there's something behind this that we just don't know about. Well, 40 years, 50 years later, a lot has come out, and we would have to say it is this New World Order conspiracy, the Aquarian conspiracy, that they were pushing. And there really was something behind all this. There really was a global conspiracy to push things in a certain direction. And music is the most powerful means, especially for young people. Young people tend to follow music incredibly intensely. And the introduction of the whole thing of the introduction of the drugs, you know, is another, you know, story. I mean, there was massive legal academic experimentation with hallucinogens. They did a lot of experimentation, and they were looking as just a way to control minds, and then it gets passed out to all these people, if you dig, you find out more and more and more and more and more that there was an agenda. There was an agenda going on. So anyway, it was very depressing seeing this, because we realized that our lives have been manipulated and controlled way more than we realize. And this caused me a great deal of suffering and misery, because I was trying to get a handle on the music scene. That was my natural inclination from the samskaras I had previous life, and maybe more than one life too. And so I said, I have to get a handle on this music scene. Well, you know, I couldn't get a handle on it, because I said, something is out of whack here. This is too weird. I cannot. So I kept, you know, just lurching here and lurching there and dead end here, and I was just all turned around in so many different directions. I was just lost, because I didn't understand, you know, what's at play here. I don't think anybody really understood what was at play. There's most certainly a shadow government in this world that employs behavioral psychologists, psychiatrists, doctors of all types, you know, think tanks, policy people, these massive, you know, philanthropic, you know, operations that basically hire a lot of top brain power to come up with advice of how, you know, how are we going to, you know, shape the world. There's no question that's been going on. So it's these people that are desperate, because they're not quite getting what they want. They're not quite getting what they want. They may have underestimated various factors. And it's very likely they're going to make a big play for checkmate, try to get checkmate. And like I said, these people are not, you don't feel comfortable around them, really. There's something, there's some kind of deadness. They sort of feel dead, you know. They're all left-brained, you know, so left-brained and you know, structure and order and numbers and equations like this and control and, you know, profits and greed and, you know, just blueprints, you know. There's so much that way. Even now, I think about the LA scene, it churns my stomach, you know, it churns my stomach. That whole situation had some dark hand at work at it, no doubt about it. So, they're reaching a point of sheer desperation now. And so we have all these indicators, programmed indicators, in the media, in various places, pointing to September 23rd, some of them to 2:15, actually, directly. And lo and behold, the Pope and the President are meeting on September 23rd, 2:15. You know, so that's an impossible coincidence. Impossible coincidence. Now, you know, some people say it's way worse than we know, and I would say it probably is. We don't know exactly how bad things are, but it's likely it's way worse than we know. And so, you know, I feel it's time to bring in the, you know, spiritual consciousness. The deer represents spiritual consciousness, non-dual spiritual consciousness. It's time that, you know, that they come out in the open. Whatever help we have must come out in the open, because we're not quite able to do it ourselves, actually. This is what I find in myself. I'm not quite able to do it myself. We need some help right now. I'm based on the devious desperation of a group that's been working for a long time, actually. Long time, hundreds of years. I just remember in the 60s that the military-industrial complex, they just felt they ruled us, you know. They tried to take over then in a lot of ways. And there was a pushback, but then it got co-opted, and then high technology came in. So what will we get? What will we get? It's possible. Another indication. I don't want to tip things. I have to be somewhat a little bit vague as far as locations of this and that, or what's going on here. But I had another indication that it could be that there's some great spiritual teachers are right in front of us. They're just about ready to they've come into the scene, and they're just now right in front of us, because they certainly know that this next 9 months is going to be extraordinarily desperate. 40 weeks from the 17th equals June 22nd, 2016, 40 months gestation period, the birth of the New World Order. So, you know, they're desperate to get it born by June 22nd. I believe June 22nd. At least we need to be ready by that time. And it's likely that they'll want to have it born, so to speak, in a form that is that people can readily identify, oh, you know, this is the New World Order. Okay, we're joining it. We're decided to go this way. They're going to have some sort of agreement in place that so it's not so shadowy now, where it comes out in the open. So you're likely to see the New World Order come out in the open, come out in the open. Google has already started doing this. And you're liable to see the veil lifted. It's the apocalypse, so you're going to see the veil lifted on this New World Order more and more and more and more and more. So it may be then that the spiritual adepts, you know, are going to come out in the open too. This could very well happen. And I actually expect it to happen. Now, when those deer burst forth, I was in a wow state of mind. It was very what would you say? Slightly stunning. My eyes got big, you know. And it's wow. So out of nowhere, I wasn't even thinking. I thought it's all over, you know, where we lost, and suddenly, boom, 1, 2, 3. Right out in the open. So, maybe out of nowhere, there may be three spiritual teachers suddenly come out in the open. I've said Jesus, Rama Maharshi, and Longchenpa are three that I believe may very well do that somehow. And keep in mind, they don't have to be born. They can just appear. See, this is very important. Like those deer just burst out of the thicket. They can just appear. In fact, I was, yesterday, I think I was praying. I said, hey, you don't have to be born. That's ridiculous for you. Just appear. We'll accept an appearance. Now, this would certainly be quite a situation, wouldn't it? Now, I believe I could handle this wonderfully. I look forward to it. What if Rama Maharshi suddenly appeared in the world? Says, I'm back, and it looks pure as his flesh. He said, well, I told you I wouldn't leave you. I didn't say I wouldn't come back. Right? What if Jesus shows up in the flesh here as an appearance? And they say, well, where, you know, who's your mother? I don't have any. I just manifested here. I just appeared here. I have the power to do that. What if Longchenpa just appeared here? Now that would certainly tip the equation. And I just thought about that yesterday. Oh, I was on the ninth hole, and there was a group of two deer down on the left of the fairway, and a group of three deer on the right of the fairway, near to me, close to me, very close to me. In the distance there on the left, there were two deer, and near to me on the right, there were three deer. So you have on the left, you have two and three, so it's 23 right there. Plus, you could be the Pope and the President meeting the leftists, they're neo-Marxist humanists, which is leftist progressive agenda, which is the continuity for agenda. And so two of those, and then close to me on the right, three deer, maybe three spiritual teachers. Now, of course, in India, they know that spiritual teachers show up. They just appear. They may have left, you know, sometime or previous in history, and on occasion they show up. The Babaji, you know, is for one, shows up occasionally here and there. Not Harakan Babaji necessarily, but he said to do that too. But you know, they're aware that from time to time these gurus just appear. And then they disappear. Nobody knows where they went. They just let their appearance go back into undifferentiatedness or subtleness. So what if three teachers just suddenly appeared here? Now that would get the boys into these alphabet agencies thinking a little bit, wouldn't it? And girls too, girls are probably running the show right now. And it's, you know, I've, you know, gone over this and over this and over this and over this and over this, but it's not that important to go over it again. But the issue is, what if three teachers suddenly appeared? Historic teachers that, you know, what if Jesus said, okay, I already said Jesus is back in the world. I don't know if he's has a body appearance. I saw him in a dream with a body appearance, May 1st, April 31st, May 1st, that time frame. And what if he just shows up here? It's bodily, you know? I just like would say, ah, this is getting good now. This is getting really good. I like this. Now, you know, those who are doing all this behind, you know, underhanded control game and all this stuff, you know, they're desperate. And you know, we don't want to actually encourage their desperation by our own failure, you know, by being pulled into it. Because then they might think, like, wow, this really works, you know. So we keep doing it. Because there's something a little bit unseemly about it, really. I don't want, you know, fellow spirit, members of the one family of spirit, which we all are in perfect standing. You know, there's something a little bit unseemly about what they're doing, and so I don't want to encourage it. So I think, you know, we need to put a halt to it, put a stop to it, or at least liberate ourselves from it, just for their sake, you know, so they can say, oh, well, it wasn't that bad. So they, you know, they such and such and such, they managed to escape from it, and some kind of saving grace for them, you know. I really feel that way. I, you know, it's sad that they're so caught up in what they're caught up in, because which is the continuity fear. So I think it would be a very compassionate thing to do, is to, you know, flip the script on them. And keep in mind, all those musical groups, no one was ever drafted. And of course, here we all are terrified of being drafted. And this is like on everyone's freaking out about this. And yet these people, like, are somehow immune to it, you know. They seem to be immune to a lot of stuff. Like, you know, they get record contracts, recording contracts, traveling, equipment, and, you know, studio musicians in the best studios in the world, you know, recording their songs, and here we are, you just, like, you know, in our garage, just like saying, what the heck's going on here? I said, a lot of us said, we can play better than that. I said, I can do better than that. Now, that's none of these groups, they're famous, you know. I said, I can do better music than that easily. What the heck's going on here? And a lot of people that felt that way, you know, and there were bands that were, like, way better, but you never heard of them. Lots of them. You start digging into it, you start finding out a lot of stuff that's very, very compelling. The music scene was not what we thought it was, not some organic thing, like new age thing, you know. The Aquarian, it was part of the Aquarian conspiracy for sure. You know, pseudo spirituality too. It was a lot of pseudo, and nasty. It was some sort of, you know, warfare really going on then. Very bad. A lot of casualties from it. So they can get real nasty. The situation can get really, really nasty. And I guess I've been told it's going to be twice as nasty as it was back then, at least. In the dream last night, there was all these flinging massive amounts of mud and burying people in mud, which is another, the dark brown color we've been talking about in terms of the sky. It's interesting here, the backdrop, the sides are kind of brownish. In the middle, it's white, which is the same. This is my fingernail here, where I got this, you know, deep brown, this way, deep brown color, and with white in the middle. You can see it sort of there, whitish in the middle. It's very, very, very similar. It's not showing up too well right now, but I've shown you before. There's this big white spot in the middle that's just been developing out of nowhere. So where did this come from? Well, it's kind of the backdrop here is also this white spot with brown around it. It's incredible what the musicians got away with. I've always studied this, you know, the musicians that on their tours and everything, it's like they were being protected somehow. I mean, if the government wanted to take out these musicians, they would have all been taken out post haste, easily. They would all have been arrested and thrown in jail for 20 years. I mean, easily. And nothing happened to them. Hardly anything. A couple of them, I guess, went too far, but yeah, for, by and large. Not everybody was on board with letting them do whatever they wanted to do, and so sometimes they got in a little bit of trouble. And were they all just incredibly lucky that none of them got drafted, none of their draft numbers ever, their last names never came up? It's just like complete insane luck. No. And of course, people from that time, a lot of them, you know, will defend it, just absolutely defend the times, you know, say, no, it was all completely organic, completely legitimate, we had a great time, there's nothing wrong. It was just, no, that's not true at all. It was a very weird time. And you can understand when people going to college, you know, high school, college, and they're making these friendships and stuff. That's something they want to cherish the rest of their life. Okay, that's fine. But for those who are really serious intent about really understanding what's going on, recognizing it, you know, it's a whole different story. When you really recognize this, you realize, uh-oh, we really did go down the rabbit hole. Speaking of that, I'm driving the golf course along, and there's just massive amounts of rabbits. I'm driving through, all the rabbits are scurrying around. It's like I'm in, you know, the rabbit hole, or getting out of the rabbit hole, so to speak. I said, let just one rabbit not run. Okay, I want to see, just give me a sign, God. Let's let one rabbit not run. Why are they all running away? So I drove my cart, and there was this one rabbit very close. It was just munching grass, and it kind of looked up at me and just kind of kept, and didn't run. All the other rabbits ran, but there was this one that did not run away. Didn't, you know, take shelter in their rabbit holes or something. I said, ah, great, great, there's at least one. So, are we living in a mystic time, extremely mystical time? Possible. Very possible. Okay, this is what I'm trying to get at. It is very possible. Not only are we living in the apocalyptic times, not only are we living in the end times, not only are we living in the time when the New World Order will attempt to seize, you know, operational control of this planet. Not only are we living the times where, you know, the tribulation period, is going to unfold somehow. Not only that, but we may be living in extraordinarily mystical times. Extraordinary spiritual times. Now, I've always believed that the great teachers are coming back. I believe I've been told that they are, but they didn't come back on any sort of timetable that made any sense to me. Why are they waiting, you know, so long? It doesn't make any sense. But, you know, how do we understand their ways and timings? It just seems impossible for us to understand it. So I got very disconsolate and upset. Now, I was thinking about, what would these teachers do? What would we want? What would we want? Well, I'll tell you what we want is avoid the blame game. Now, I'm looking back at all this hell of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and on and on, you know, just the attempt to destroy our culture, which has gone so far now, and implement a global corporate culture around the world. And you feel, you know, angry. You feel like blaming somebody. And I said, of course, this is a trick, because it's really only the dance of continuity fear. That's all it is. You must avoid blaming anyone, or else you yourself get pulled into self-delusion. And so the number one thing for us would be to avoid the blame game. Avoid the blame game. Now, what if there were these teachers who are just, you know, in radiant bliss and peace, surround just the whole atmosphere is full of peace, and they're just not aware of anything that bad that's happening? There's no such thing as bad. They're just, there's no reactivity in them, just absolute love and joy, you know, just pouring out. You know, we could just feel that, and that would like take us out of this blame game sort of situation. Now, back in the 60s, we had the New Left, you know, which was the against, you know, the war and against corporations, the New Left, the New Hard Left. And they were very angry and activist. You know, you got Abby Hoffman, Jerry Rubin, and the Yippies and all that, and the Weather Underground and all this various stuff. That was the New Left, the Hard Left. They were very, very angry. You know, yet yeah, I mean, they were bombing stuff. What's the POTUS's buddy? I can't remember his name. Just as well I don't. In Chicago, the Weather Underground, blowing up stuff, blowing up. I mean, they were furious people. And that was the New Left. And they didn't like the hippies, because the hippies were too stoned to get angry. You know, the hippies were just like, well, you know, just pass the joint, you know. And that's about it. You know, just, yeah, man, everything's cool. So the hippies were not angry people, you know, make love, not war. They were just kind of hedonists, you know, kind of naturalist hedonists. Just wanted to feel good. And so they were kind of attracted to spirituality, kind of just, they were not so heavily into the blame game. But there was this dichotomy between the New Left, Students for Democratic Society, what it was, our free speech movement, you know, civil rights movement, the activists, the whole New Left thing, and the hippies. And big, big difference. I'm not against hippies at all. I mean, I found a lot of them, you know, a lot of good qualities in the hippies. Some that you know, not as good. They, They weren't as spiritual as they maybe thought they were, let's put it that way. And they got too obsessed with, whole food and vitamins and nature cures, and they ended up getting into this whole pagan sort of obsession. And so it sort of, it didn't go, as far as it could have gone at all, unfortunately. But some of the hippies like to sit around quietly, like to sit quietly, which is very good. Some of the deadheads love to, dance, 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 take drug, dance, dance, dance. But some hippies just like to sit quietly. And they went on, to a spiritual path. Some of the hippies went on to a spiritual path, actually. I was on the outskirts, edges of everything, observing everything, saying, "What's going on here?" And also aware, of what's to come in the world, and saying, "Wait, how can we move this, in a better direction here?" And so I was certainly on the fringes of all this stuff, aware of it. Of course, drugs take a lot of the starch out of the spiritual path, and you're just sitting there. They're sitting there quietly because they're too stoned to move. That's not really meditation. That's cheating. I mean, it doesn't work. So, but the idea, the thing is to avoid the blame game. Avoid the blame game. We could be helped in that, This is what I'm worried about. I'm worried about the blame game. I'm worried. That's what the continuity fear wants to pull us into, is blame game. The blame game. Chaos. Someone said that one of the psychops that was done was called Operation Chaos, actually. Now they certainly succeeded. They came produced a very chaotic situation. The music was very chaotic. Some say they had dancers at well, there's so much deceit in the music. I mean, for one thing, if you go back and look at a lot of the performances of the 60s and all those bands, etc., there's a massive amount of lip syncing going on. For one thing, you get the musicians on stage and they're playing everything, and they almost always had these wild freak out go-go dancers in the performances. This freak troupe about Laurel Canyon, I can't remember his name, but his name is now popping up more and more. He's the leader of this, the freaks. And they introduced this freak style of dancing. And they would go to all these clubs and dance, and people more paid more attention to them than the musicians, because the musicians could hardly play. They're terrible. And people say, "Oh, we're not, it doesn't matter. We're all stoned and on drugs, and these crazy dancers are freaking out and dancing, and it's just like it's a scene. So it doesn't really matter what the music sounds terrible and disjointed and chaotic. It doesn't really matter." Well, as you go through the 60s and you see all these performances, they always have these, go-go dancers, and people are doing sort of, it's more a little more stylish, the frug and the shimmy and the watusi and the twist, and but it's quite frenetic and chaotic and freaky, the dance and the way they were dancing. We're not talking about ballroom dancing here. And so musicians did not play were not very good. And so you have the musicians playing on stage. I'm noticing this, being a longtime musician. I have a sort of overall feel for music, and I said something isn't right at all. But I'll tell you the truth: nobody from our generation back then, nobody knew about lip syncing. Okay. It wasn't. I think it came out Milli Vanilli. Eventually, they caught them lip syncing, and it became a big deal. Before that, it wasn't known. But I'll tell you this: of almost everything was lip synced. So much stuff was lip synced. Because you have like these horns and violins and all these instruments playing, but on bass you got the drummer, the keyboardist, the bass and the guitar and singer, and that's all you got. But you have all this backing stuff going. I said, wait a minute, where's the horn section? Where are the violins? Where's this? Where's this? Where's this? This is I don't see it. Plus, you go back and you look, and the instruments aren't even plugged into anything a lot of times. They didn't have wireless back then. They were lip syncing. They were lip syncing, and the records that they supposedly made, they didn't make them. They were made and produced by these studios, studio musicians, studio producers. So there are these funny dressed up, guys and their funny haircuts, and they're jiving around there and, singing like, oh yeah, and like here we're watching, oh wow, that sounds great, well, look how they're so talented, because they got the best musicians in the world, the 18th, the wrecking crew in LA, these are the best musicians in the world. They're the ones who made the songs. You get somebody maybe wrote some lyrics. They probably were helped out, but yeah, some stoned lyric, whatever. Think they're poetic or something. Then you get this, and then you get the producer say, okay, but let's make this a song. How to make this a hit? You bring these producers and engineers and the best musicians in the world in, and they say, okay, let's try this, let's try this, let's try this. What are their voices like? Eventually they may have to go on tour, so we'll try to put it in a key that they can eventually sing, and. You have these songs being poured out. So here we are watching this, and we say, oh my God, these people are very talented. This is what confused me. I said, this music is fabulous. I had an extreme ear for music, and I said, wow, these bands are awesome. Well, those bands weren't doing the playing on the records. And then they're getting up there, they're lip syncing and pretending to play. They're not even playing at all, they're just pretending to play. So this is an extreme psyop, on us really, because we thought that, oh, they're just like teenagers. They said, look what teenagers can do, and you can, oh, I can do it. I should be able to do it too. Where's my contract? Where's my equipment? Where, how come I can't get up on stage and sound like that? And when I get up on stage, it doesn't sound anything like that. They get up on stage, they play. It's this beautiful, balanced song, song and. And the harmonies are so great. It's like, wow. Well, they're playing the studio song, and lip syncing to it. Didn't know that. Didn't know the studio musicians. Didn't know how everything was being produced. And this just radically skewed our entire youth, actually, because so many people are focused on music at that time, and we thought these people were so incredibly great. And then later, like when they go out and try to on their own try and make these albums, music sounds terrible. They say, what happened? What's going on here? So they misled the kids, didn't they? They absolutely did. You think, well, it's not a big deal. It actually is a big deal if you start digging into it. We are given a very, very false impression of what is possible, what should be happening for us. This is what's going on. These people really are this talented. Therefore, we put enormous trust in them. I said, my God, they wrote this song, they produced this song, this album, these are geniuses, Wow. The lyrics must really mean something. They must be very important. We need to follow these people, this group. We need to, if they say something like that, dress a certain way, we said, maybe this is how geniuses dress, musical geniuses dress. Because keep in mind that the studio musicians who were playing on these